Wake up. The sleeping must wake up. Halli hello and once again welcome to the Matrixers with Jonathan and the pretty Shiva. Yes, our topic today is the seven stages of awakening. Actually, there are only three main steps, but you can also divide it into intermediate steps. And we thought that was important, because that's also a small point of motivation, that you don't think, oh, from step one to step three, oh God, I'll never make it. But there are always small intermediate steps of awakening, and that is also very important, I think, that you know and know all of them, so that you know where you are right now and what awaits you next. Yes, I think that's an important topic that you should have discussed so that you can look into it yourself. Well, how far am I on my spiritual path, on my path to my true self? And yes, get out of the matrix. And of course, out of the matrix. How far are you or how far are you? And so we have divided the stages of awakening into seven stages and we want to share them with you today. Exactly. So this is now for the people who don't take the black portals or loopholes. Very few will probably do that. Hence our seven steps. Yes, our seven steps. So level one. The awakening of the pineal gland. N.A. The first and I would say the most important step. That has to happen. That's the initiation, you could say. And the awakening of the pineal gland. And how that is expressed. So in general, you can see that when people get into middle age, i.e. into midlife crisis, they first start to think about their lives and then often change their diet. In order to eat healthier, they often change their entire way of life, which leads to the fact that, what they don't even know, the pineal gland also decalcifies. And suddenly it starts to glow a bit more. And yes, as I have found, this is the initiation for many people to rethink and to go more in the direction of spirituality, because they become healthier and the pineal gland awakens a little and people then suddenly take another look, get the full story. Yes, that's my experience, what I've observed. Of course, there are still people who were born with an active pineal gland from the start. There's not much to do with awakening. You just have to pursue it and refine it and deepen it. Of course, there are other ways that people get the pineal suddenly awakened, and that's through intense emotional distress, trauma, and yes, anything that puts them in shock, emotional shock. Then the pineal gland can suddenly awaken and suddenly the view of everything is completely different. Yes, these are my observations of how the pineal gland suddenly awakens. Yes, as Rumi said, what did Rumi say? The breach is the opening for the light to enter. Rumi is always right. Rumi is always right. Yes, pineal awakening. Yes, you can now imagine them so much under it. Pineal awakening. How does it look? Is she just saying, I'm awake? Did she crack at some point? Suddenly, bam, in your head, ah, okay. Yes. Well, the first symptoms, I would say, are that you are suddenly interested in spiritual abilities. For example, one suddenly wants to become a healer or is completely fascinated by fantasy images. Or you feel magically attracted to the forest and then enjoy your walks in the forest. Well, those are the first signs. Other signs are that you can remember your dreams better, or that every now and then you have the feeling that you could empathize better with other people, unless your empathic skills increase a little, or the intuition gets a little better. And these are the beginnings, I would say, where the pineal gland awakens in humans. Maybe you've already noticed that with friends, that they suddenly have a small change of heart and are then interested in such things, although you previously thought that nothing would come of it. Yes. Yes, I've also had emails from people who then said, yes, Jonathan, you won't believe it. My parents have always closed themselves off to such things and now they suddenly start reading such things and get books who have to do with spirituality or are interested in spiritual things or want to hear something from me and the like. So you can already see a change taking place in the world. For example, if I think back 20 years, because I've been writing in the Matrix blog for almost 20 years now, and then, 20 years ago, it was the case that very rarely someone wrote to me and nowadays many more people write, many. More people write about spiritual things, how they develop, what they have experienced, how it turned out for them. And there I see a strong increase in interest in spirituality, in spiritual, magical and things that just help you on your way inwards. What I also noticed when you look at the workshops 10 years ago or the workshops today is that the topics are also very different. 10 years ago it was just something like Reiki or I don't know what. And nowadays card reading. Cartomancy, and today people are actually interested in the Matrix. How to get out of the Matrix. They actually become more open to the fact that there is something going on behind the scenes that they actually had nothing to do with before. Yes, that's right, you're right. A lot has happened there too. The themes back then were more of an esoteric kind, i.e. esoteric in the sense of Reiki, card reading, horoscopes and something like that. People came up to you and said, well, I would like to have a horoscope drawn up, etc. And there the interest has receded more into the background, as far as the esoteric topics are concerned. And the swing goes more in the direction of spirituality. But activate more inner abilities. Learn out of body experience, lucid dreaming, train, etc. That's right, one can say, it's more from the outside in. But that shouldn't be against card reading or clairvoyant abilities or channeling. On the contrary, it also helps some people on their way inward, of course. But yes, you can see the swing, yes, that's how it is. There are also ways to support this, to activate the pineal gland. Perhaps, before we move on to the next level, we should also address that again. What are the ways of secretly getting other people to activate the pineal gland? A joke. I have something for you, Mom. Here, try this pill. That's super tasty. Yes, so decalcify the pineal. Of course, you can take advantage of the opportunity in various ways, through nutrition. Simply by eating less, eating healthier, healthier in the sense of not going to McDonald's, but going more in the direction of paleo. So original food, just rice, meat and vegetables. Yes, no meat is also vegan. Even better raw food, super optimal, to increase the energy. Probably hardly anyone can do it and you should force them into do it. That's a topic in itself anyway, nutrition. The ghosts are arguing. But pure diet, then of course supplements, lots of cedar nut oil, borax. What else do we think of then? Oh God, spirulina, spirulina chlorella what? Chlorella oh God. Bentonite, zeolite. Yes, what else do we have? Ah, enterogel also helps against the chemtrails. So everything that we are now listing not only helps to decalcify the pineal gland, but also really cleans up and detoxifies the whole body. And very strong, but we'll make another video about that, an extra video. How to dose it, how to use it, at what times of the day and. Exactly. Now only roughly so that you know that there are also ways to decalcify the pineal gland. Other possibilities are of course spiritual literary blogs. You can even recommend Facebook, sometimes with books. Good channeling material like Seth. I can of course also recommend them, or Castaneda, of course. So there is something else. Are you still going to suggest literature? Yes, yes, that's definitely a good thing. So, just stay away from the big press. They have their own interpretation of reality, and that's why I recommend reading more private blogs. Like the Matrix blog. Yes. Exactly. But there are also many other blogs that are managed by people or authors who really look behind the scenes and don't just accept everything without question. So I could suggest two more blogs, for example Denk Anders' blog, which always has very profound topics, or transinformation.net. Who do you know there? Yes, I would perhaps recommend Dieter Bro. He's also a very dedicated scientist, so he's really trying to bridge the gap between science and spirituality. I have also spoken to him several times and he is a very personable man and he knows what he is talking about. Yes, highly I would also definitely recommend Bruno, the Bruno Wurtemberger, because he has power from A to Z, also from ego to everything that has to do with it. So, also a good man in any case. Yes, there are quite a few that we can recommend to you. Well, literature doesn't know. Yes, Jane Roberts would be recommended. Jane Roberts is a medium from the 70s. And she channeled the personality Seth and she just dictated books to this personality and provides a very good overview of the spiritual topics. Talk about everything and yes, that would also be an opportunity to recommend these works to others, where you think, yes, I would like to see that something happens to the pineal gland of the person. And there's another good thing for me. Exactly, I still have the Euphoria series and that's for people who don't actually have anything to do with it yet. You can give it to your mother. The book and the Euphoria series by Nina Nell, it's actually more of a fantasy series, but it really goes into depth beyond the books and really starts from A and really up to the very highest awakening goes. So it's a very long series. We've got 7 or 8 books and it really, really builds on each other and most people will probably enjoy the first book. It's about a girl named Lucy and yes, that's where it starts. So I can really recommend it. I read it then too. Not now. Yes. I read that back then too. Well, Richard Bach is also very good for beginners. So if you would like to lend such a book or give it to a person whose pineal gland you want to stimulate a bit, I can also recommend Richard Bach. Jonathan the Seagull was his most famous work, or the work Illusionin is also great. And yes, that's for the people who are all just striving towards the first stage of awakening. Wake up. Wake up. You're dreaming. So. awaken. So now comes the second stage. Awakening from the system. Yes, very, very exciting and also very important, because there is a lot going on behind the scenes that you don't see directly. We think everything is going according to plan, at least that's what most people think. They like to get upset about the politicians, but actually there is much, much more play that you don't notice. And behind the government is actually the true government, which our government actually knows nothing about and much more. Yes, the awakening in the system or out of the system, or rather, that would be the stage for me, the first people realize that something is wrong here with this world. Or goes in that direction, the first thought. I find that so exciting too, you know? People have been to the moon, haven't they? Allegedly. Supposedly they were. Yes, yes. We humans have already been to the moon and there are computers with which you can do the most amazing things. People are always striving for independence, self-employment and the like, and they all want to be as grown up and educated as possible, but they still have a mommy or a daddy, just the government who tells them what to do. Whether you're allowed to fish, where you can park, yes, and who you still give money to. For being able to breathe, for being allowed to breathe, here CO2 tax and all that. So this polarized attitude in the world is interesting to observe. And yes, look in the direction of the arms industry, pharmaceutical industry, food industry, shit man, what's behind it all? Well, that's when you realize that all the governments actually always back the same horse. Strangely enough, if a rule was devised somewhere, then the other states also consider doing the same thing. Any why is this the case? That's when you start to think. And at some point in the second stage of awakening you realize, listen, all the heads of government are all very similar. All manipulated. And that's because all governments, or at least most, are influenced and controlled by a shadow government. What was the last name you called her? The deep state, yes, exactly. The deep state. So the state that is behind the states. And of course they can then say to every state, CO2 taxes here, we have to enforce that now, and then of course some governments come along and then say yes here climate change and the like, we have to. Introduce CO2 taxes so that climate change gets better again. It all comes from the Anunnaki. Yes, anyway. And that's where the second stage of awakening begins, that one recognizes, yes. That you question first. That one questions, and that one gradually understands that all these governments are all controlled and that in politics one is really only dealing with puppets. And that's when you start to question how the system is structured, what's actually right and what's wrong. You suddenly realize on television and in the newspapers that all the news from the big press, etc., everyone is always trying to influence people in a certain direction. So that the whole system is set up in such a way that the church works together with it. The financial system. The financial system works with those who work psychology, biology, all science, all together. Except for the ones that are independent right now, but most are. Most do. All these natural sciences are also sponsored by companies. They say yes to the natural sciences. Here, I would like to have this and have that. and because that brings me a really nice profit and you should research that now, i.e. all the media, etc. Everything is agreed. Everything is planned. Everything has a system, and then in the second stage of awakening you begin to understand, to question and also to realize that somewhere there is a rotten side. And then you just start to see through more and more, and within this, let's say political system or financially influenced system, and also to understand that actually everything is different than it is repeatedly portrayed. That's also a kind of leaving the matrix, our worldly matrix. When you question it, look behind it and then try to get out of there as well. Yes, one could also see that it also represents a certain exit from the matrix, at least on the information level, and of course, the deep state controls a lot there. They then also have their programs, which they then define, and through one or the other detour, they always manage to get many governments to follow them. Yes. Let's come to the third stage of awakening. The dream awakening. That is, the awakening that you suddenly realize in dreams, oh, there are alternative realities. Parallel worlds. I am in many dreams, I'm not just one. Yes, that would be the third level of awakening. Awaken. The sleeping one must awaken. One or the other can now object. Yes, exactly. You remember your dreams better and you realize that you have other friends in your dreams. Or maybe you live in a different place, and more those of you who keep dream diaries or have a very good dream memory then realize, ah, there are even more realities in which I am somehow still me, but with something else environment. Or with another activity, with another partner, other friends, etc. And that's when the dream awakening begins, and you can see that I'm not the only one. But there are still several versions of myself. So I am not the center of all realities. Just as little as it was said in the Middle Ages that the Earth is the center of the universe, everything else revolves around the Earth. It is not so. Also regarding the realities that exist. We are just one reality among many, and you can find that out through dreaming. Also in the way quantum physics depicts it. Yes, the pineal gland is already more active in this stage because you have dealt with it a lot more and maybe you have changed your life a bit. That the pineal you may already have expanded states of consciousness from time to time. See that there are also alternative realities or completely different dimensions. One no longer only thinks three-dimensionally, but realizes that there are also 4D, 5D, 6D. You suddenly become interested in out-of-body experience. Maybe you have already experienced out-of-body experience and realize, oh, you are not just the body after all. Like this. In this direction. And that you are actually somehow more multidimensional and not just 3D. Yes, I would say that is the third thing, that you become more multidimensional, parallel to the top, so to speak, alternative realities and other dimensions. That's the way it is. So all of your dreams are alternate realities that you visit every night. You are always a different version of yourself there. It can be very similar to your familiar everyday world, sometimes a little different. Yes, but my dreams are always so abstract and crazy and washed out, and I can't imagine that these are different realities. If the dreams are like this, illogical, slurred, and the like, That's not a sign that alternate realities don't exist. Also, no indication that the existence of alternative realities or whose visits would be nonsense, but depends on the ability to dream, on the ability of the dreamer itself. Because if the dreamer isn't sufficiently trained in dreaming, then the dreams will also seem confused or illogical or where it's hard to imagine, hey, these are alternative realities. And that's the problem. Why dreams are often seen as a processing of reality or as meaningless brain fire when you're asleep or something like that. Or just brain spook in the head or various scenes that simply arise in the brain. All nonsense. It is up to the dreamer's ability. And the better the dreamer is trained, the more he has dealt with the subject of dreams, the more clearly he dreams and even recognizes that every dream has its own continuity, just like everyday life. So it's a matter of perception. So you mean that if you visit once in a dream and come back 10 years later, you realize that reality continued? Yes, it is. So okay, these dream realities continue. You visit them at night. It may be that you dreamed something. In 2010 and in 2012, you revisit the dream. It has happened to you, exactly, and you suddenly notice that there has been a development. That is, the dream realities continue to run independently, regardless of whether the dreamer visits this dream reality or not. Because they are just as real as we are here. And every now and then, when they are asleep, one of them will connect with you and see what you do in your everyday life. You always forget that, the direction. But that's what they do. Unfortunately, you usually don't notice when another consciousness from another reality joins in. But then they also think, what did I dream about today? In that direction. I had a weird dream today. I watched a video with two guys, a blonde and a long-haired guy. So I know that was a weird dream. That's what they think then. And the alternative itself, which is joining in right now, watching this video. Best regards. Yes, what I was able to determine is that in the third stage you start to deal more with energies. So you're already moving towards stage 4. We'll get to that in a moment. But energies, energy bodies, chakras, cleansing, and yes, that comes up in level 4 right away. Yeah, okay, then the fourth stage one would call it the heart awakening. So in other words, you see through the duality, the illusion of the ego, and go in the direction of freedom of judgment. It's not the case that the ego then immediately dissolves or something, but you just see through the duality, go more into the heart, listen to your heart, feel your heart, go more into love. And let things be as they are without condemning, judging, or evaluating. So speak freedom of judgment. And it's not always all good, bad, just freedom of judgment. So no more or less duality in any case. It depends on how far you have awakened in the heart. It's not exactly that you wake up and then everything is fine. Of course, that is also a process that you go through, and at first it's a bit like that, and then more, 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 more. The more you realize that all this is just an illusion and that the matrix is structured into good and bad, i.e. dual, the more you go deeper into your heart. That's how I would describe it briefly. Yes, so in the fourth level you have also strengthened your empathic skills a lot. This means that you are able to empathize with others very well and then also perceive their perspective. And then you also realize that every consideration of a situation of an issue is just a matter of perspective. And that's where you learn to drop this dualistic thinking. You then suddenly not only always understand the hero in a film, but you also begin to understand the villain. So you can understand both sides, not only Batman, but also the Joker. So you can just start to understand, the Batman acts that way and that way and the Joker that way and that way. That's when you start to understand. Example, Batman is the superhero or one of the many superheroes that can be seen on television. He's a man who always helps people, which of course is great. But at the same time, oh great, that's why superhero. And for the reason he helps other people but is on the side of the law. And who is drafting the law? Deep state. Right. And then you realize, yes, Batman is a superhero, but he's actually defending the manipulated system, which is designed to prolong the awakening of humanity as much as possible. So you see advantages and disadvantages of Batman and the Joker as well. The Joker is a villain. He has no problems there. Even if a house explodes somewhere and one or the other dies, but on the other hand he is a system opponent. I would say he's a rebel. Yes, he is actually a rebel, and that's where sacrifices have to be made. End of the story. Well, yes, and you can understand both sides and at the same time understand that good and bad is really just a matter of interpretation. And only take place at our level in the matrix. That's how it is. Because every person always acts from the perspective of the constructive. Everyone actually wants to make a contribution to improving the world. Because there is no such thing as really deep, genuine evil. Actually, that doesn't exist. Or the really deep, real, good doesn't really exist either. Everyone is a subject and therefore thinks subjectively. Whether he's a scientist, a politician, a banker, or a superhero, or a villain, or whatever. These are all just designations to divide into good and bad. In the end, everyone actually acts from their perspective for the good or for the constructive. And that's exactly what you see in the fourth level of awakening. You rise above duality. One recognizes that the duality simply represents a perspective or a classification as what is good for oneself and what is evil for oneself. But everyone decides that subjectively. There is no objective consideration or classification of good and bad. It's always subjective. Exactly. What can you do to get in that direction? We all have chakras. And yes, you shouldn't forget this part of the matrix either. But we have them and they are still a connection to the true self and to where we really want to be. And that's also why you have to take them into account in order to work with them. You can ignore them, but they don't do that much, because everything you've experienced in a trauma or no idea what, that too is stored everywhere and in your chakras and energy system and energy bodies, and that's why it's important, even a little bit too. Clean up and then also to have the opportunity to open the heart and to go out of duality. If you leave duality or see through duality, then the chakras open all by themselves, I would almost say, or you can also accelerate it through chakra work. This realization of stepping out of duality or in that direction. Yes, you can actually talk about it for hours, but we only want to tell you about the stages, and that's why we come to stage number 5. Yeah, and pretty cool too. I've already seen that this works, and that it will be like this at some point, but as far as I know, no one has reached stage number 5. None that I know. I've seen a dream once, or in a hypnagogic state, and we don't want to keep you in suspense any longer. Namely, stage number 5. Lucid becoming an everyday, that's crazy. And that's difficult to achieve. Yes, it's not that easy because by engaging with the dreams and the alternate realities and also by getting into the state of lucidity there, that means that within a dream, while you're dreaming, you realize that you're dreaming. And that's called lucidity or clarity in the dream. The whole dream then suddenly turns from a vague cloudy dream into a crystal clear dream that is as clear as everyday reality with continuity, with all the trimmings. And as soon as you have achieved this and are achieving it more and more often, at some point you start to question everyday reality. Completely automatically, nothing else remains. You can't get around it. At some point, when you've been lucid in dreams more often, you start to think, what is everyday life like? Everyday life is actually just an alternative reality. Just like the alternate realities where I've been in my dreams. So if everyday life is just one alternative reality among many, can you also become lucid there? Well, what do you mean? I saw that once or twice recently. And if at some point you manage to become lucid in everyday life, then you have the opportunity to wake up in your true reality and then you can be anywhere. You've been dreaming about it lately, right? There we were already lucid in everyday life and in reality. So lucidity in everyday life means that you actually come to your senses in everyday life. It becomes clear in everyday life, and then you also recognize that everyday life is also a dream or another or the alternative reality in which one has just moved every day. And I have dreamed several times that Jonathan has already reached this goal in the specific reality. Or the Jonathan. Is correct. I also saw a Jonathan once. Yes, he was lucid exactly. And lucidity in everyday life is of course not that easy to achieve, because recognizing the dream or life as a dream is a bit shocking. Because then you think how my whole life is just a dream. And because everything is so physical. Yes, everything is so physical and everything is so solid here. In a dream it's sometimes not like that, and that's supposed to be a dream too. That everyday reality is a dream or not isn't a question of how stable everything seems or how solid. It's just a question of perspective and interpretation and programming of the everyday dreamer. Say it. Yes, and as soon as you recognize this everyday space here, everyday dream space here as a dream, you can leave it and then all other alternative realities are open to you, to which you can then switch. Maybe you want to be in a reality where you are healthier or in a reality where you are happier. Or be in a reality where you are far more gifted and creative. I have a good example? Yes. The holodeck. Then suddenly you can. You practically recognize that you are on the holodeck and then simply choose, oh, I don't feel like doing this program anymore. Then you choose a new program. Program. The environment adapts and you're in an alternative reality. That explains it pretty well, I think. Yes, holodeck is a good example. So if you are lucid in everyday life, you would know where the computer is and where you can program it to perceive something different than what you perceive every day. Because this is nothing else, a program. One program among many, like on television. You have program 12,345, 100 million, and so it is with the alternate realities. Every TV program is a reality. But don't imagine that being so chilled with becoming lucid in everyday life. Well, when I saw that, I didn't look bad. So this becoming lucid in everyday life, that's really the way it is. Wow, it's shocking. It was a bit of a shock. So it's not like sliding down the roller coaster. Well, that's pretty shocking. You can get quite anxious, because then you recognize your entire reality as a dream and then you also realize that you have to let go of this reality. And that you're just an avatar or a robot. Yes, exactly, that one is just an avatar within this reality. It's almost as if you were playing a computer. Let's say some computer game and you move the character over there over forest and meadow and at some point you are in the game. You are the game character and at some point you recognize days in the game, weeks, months, years later. Damn, shit, that's not. I control myself from the outside all the time. You can roughly compare it to how knowledge or self-knowledge is there. Namely that you recognize that everyday life is a dream among many, many other dreams that still exist as alternatives. Yes, as soon as you become lucid, the next step comes. The next important step. Step number 6. Stage 6 of awakening. And then we have to wake up on the other side. The awakening on the other side, on the left side. We have a left self and a right self. Please refer to the digital self and the analog self video. Maybe take a look at that again, because we explain it relatively precisely there. At the end of the video we will show you that. Exactly. We actually consist of these two selves and after the lucid in everyday life comes waking up on the left side. It's a bit scarier there than here, but it's important. Nevertheless, yes, it's only the transition that's scary. Yes, only from the ego. Yes, that's a bit camouflage. But you notice it more in the dissociation than the feeling. In the sixth stage of waking up is meant literally. That means you actually wake up on the other side of reality. You wake up as a dreamer, so to speak. Oh God, I got goosebumps. That's really, that's where you wake up. Just as you wake up every morning here in everyday life, you will wake up there. Wake up, the sleeping one must. And wakes up there. And there are two possibilities. Either you awaken there on the other side of reality, shall I say, on the other side of the coin, you awaken there. You can also wake up there more often, but you may be thrown back again in the normal everyday reality and then just have the memory, I managed to wake up on the other side. But the sixth level of awakening requires everyone to be able to awaken and stay on the other side. That means that everything is really let go here and nothing more. It is no longer accessible. But then you stay there, yes, in true reality. That is the real reality, the real, yes, the real self, so to speak. There you are, too. The self that just originally intended to project a part of itself into the everyday reality you are familiar with. That's the way it is. And being awakened there also means that these great parapsychological abilities, the PSI skills, which one can achieve in this way, are also possible there. Yes, you can project yourself anywhere you want. There you can also teleport, or psychokinesis, pyrokinesis, interdimensional travel, just like that. Everything, even time, yes, then everything is possible, because you are the awakened dreamer who has recognized everyday life as a dream. And you know yourself in a lucid dream what is possible. And then many things are possible. Yes. Yes, and then we come to stage number 7. Yes. Awakening and the cocoon are practically in the true self. Right. Awakening in the cocoon. That's the perfection of awakening. That's when you realize that you're actually in the matrix shell. This is a shell around you in which every living being has been encapsulated. Every soul. And this matrix shell. Yes, you always sit in it, from morning to night. No matter what reality you are in, you are always in it. Yes, and that's where you can. Yes, that's where you are and you can see your current everyday life, which you are perceiving right now, the video that you are seeing or the environment in your room or wherever you are, all of that. You perceive within this matrix shell, namely on the inner wall. So it's a yes 3 to 4D cinema, so to speak, you could almost say that you're in there. There is only one single seat, that means only you are sitting in there, so everyone for themselves. And you can stop at that when you look around. And then you can imagine that everything you see is actually perceived within this shell. But we talk about that in great detail in our online course Out of the Matrix. Yes. Who wants to know more about it? This is a very exciting and complex topic. We are still working on the online seminar. Very busy. Very busy, and of course we will let you know when the online seminar is finished, and then of course invite you to stop by and think about whether you would like to take part in this online seminar or not. It's about the matrix shell, all these topics that we have discussed and that are somehow related to getting to the matrix or getting out of the matrix are topics in it. Exactly. Yes then, I think the video has become really long, I'm afraid. But I found the 7 steps to be quite important and you also found them very exciting. There is so much more that could be said about it. But I don't think I do. These were the 7 stages of awakening. Exactly. And we'll see each other again next time. Yes, thank you for being there. Comments nicely. And bye.